The Emanuele family in the United States began in Sant'Agata di Militello, Sicily, during the early 1900s, when Giuseppe Emanuele asked for the hand of Maria Ricciardi. Giuseppe, born August 5, 1887, the eldest son of Antonio Emanuele and Rosa Lenaro, had one brother and four sisters. His brother, Giovanni, remained in Sicily his entire life, and his descendants still make their home there. Three of his four sisters, Nunziata, Serafina, and Rosalia, all came to the U.S. in early life. Dominica, a deaf mute and very skilled seamstress, stayed at home with her mother. Neither ever came to the States. In 1901, at the age of 14, Giuseppe came with his father to America, where they worked in Cleveland, Ohio. After spending 3 years there, they returned to Sicily, then came back to the States for another 3 years, only to travel back to Sicily again so that Giuseppe could complete his military obligations. After serving his country, Giuseppe met one of the six daughters of Costantino Ricciardi and Vincenzina Cali. It would be Maria, born September 22, 1893, that would receive the young Giuseppe's visits and serenades, even though her father disapproved. In 1911, the same year of his father's death, Giuseppe and 17-year-old Maria Ricciardi married in Sant'Agata. On that year, they set out for the U.S., seeking to share the dream of many young Europeans. They were moving to find a new way of life, something to build on for themselves and for their future children. After arriving in Cleveland, Giuseppe found work in a brewery, washing bottles, and started an apprenticeship in plastering. Years later, during the Depression, he worked with his brothers-in-law, Peter and Vincent Faggio, in contracting. In 1929, having completed his apprenticeship, he came to Milwaukee with hopes of starting his own plastering business. During this time, he lived with his brothers-in-law, Charlie and Ted Prepero, who were in the excavating business. About 4 months later, when prospects for work seemed promising, Giuseppe sent for his wife and their eight children, including their eldest, Rosina Mary, her husband, Frank Calarco, and their son, Alex. They all settled in an upper flat in Milwaukee's predominantly Italian Third Ward. In 1934, Giuseppe moved his family to 1426 North Jackson, adjacent to John Ernest's Cafe, a homestead that would remain theirs for many years and become the center of big family gatherings. Children and grandchildren were invited often for spaghetti and wine. Maria made the wine herself, using grapes from a vineyard in her backyard. In 1961, after a long battle with Parkinson's disease, Giuseppe suffered a stroke and died. Maria would wear black in his memory for the next 24 years. The years following Giuseppe's death, Maria shared her house with her daughter Teresa and her husband. During this time, she kept busy with domestic work and keeping the family together. Then in 1983, after a fall, she lived with her daughter Vivian until at age 95, she quietly passed away. Born November 26, 1911, the eldest of the Emanuele children, Rose married Frank Calarco during her 15th year in 1927. At Central High School in Cleveland, Ohio, Rose was known as the best-dressed girl because she wore and owned the only fur coat. The coat, in fact, belonged to her mother. Her extravagant tastes persist today when you see the many knick-knacks and ornaments that fill her home. Rose and her husband, Frank, raised six children. For over 20 years, she was secretary, accountant, manager, and chief chauffeur for the Calarco Shoe Service Enterprises in downtown Milwaukee and the Lisbon Shopping Center, until her husband passed away in 1970. Now retired and living with her daughter, she continues to maintain her home and care for her pedigree, Lasso, Opso, pain in the ass, Randy.
Randolph, he sees me sitting here. He's worried.
Come here, honey.
Go by your nanny. Go by your nanny. Go by your nanny. Go by your nanny, honey. Yeah, yeah. Anda, anda.
What? That's not. You put any cream on.
You wise ass.
We're ready.
Okay, Eddie.
Okay. All right, being the oldest child in the family, the older sister,
yeah.
How was it when you lived at home being the oldest?
Fine. There's nothing wrong.
Did you help Grandma with the kids? And
no, I used to help everybody with the kids. Sure I did. Naturally, I was the oldest.
Sure.
I did all the work, too. The hard work.
Like what?
Like washing the breakfast set, scrubbing the kitchen, scrubbing the stairs from the second floor to the basement. Then my sister Mary, wherever I went, I had to take her. She was my bodyguard. My mother thought I was safe with her daughter.
Describe an average day for you here.
Oh, I clean house all day, wash clothes. I don't iron anymore, I quit. That's my daughter's department. Anyway, things today are wash and wear, mostly, you know.
Mm.
So a lot of that stuff, you don't even have to iron. When I was young, I used to iron sheets and towels and diapers and what have you. Everything inside, even socks I used to iron, like a dummy.
What are some of the most memorable experiences in your life? Remember anything from way back that's stuck in your mind?
Not really. I took a matter of fact.
Parties or birthdays?
Parties? No. Well, my mother used to have a party once in a while. You know, they'd have the guys playing the guitar. Like when I got engaged and they were dancing, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But nothing really elaborate. My uncles used and my aunts used to take me to the show, because my mother wouldn't let me go otherwise. Or my dad would take me. I had one escapade though. I was just 15 years old and my girlfriend from high school was there. So there used to be a theater on Mayfield Road. And I told my mother I was going by my aunt, my father's sister, who lived around there. Instead, with that girl, I said, let's go in the show. You know? So I went in the show watching the movie, and the kid, his father owned it, come up to me, says, hey, Ro, your mother's outside. So I says to Virginia, we better get out of here. So I went by my aunt. She slapped me right across the face. Why did you go to show? That I remember vividly.
Can you recall any of your earliest memories?
Oh, I remember I used to skate a lot. One thing about my mother, she'd leave me clean the house on Saturdays and go marketing with my dad, and I had to clean the house. So it was winter time, and my mother had a fish bowl, and she had goldfish in there. I felt sorry for the fish. I changed the water. I cooked them. I put hot water in there. My mother comes home. What happened to the fish? I said, gee, Ma, I thought they were cold. That's true. Really. And she always, when she went shopping, she always bought me something. Always. That I got to say about my mother. The funny thing is that when I was young, I still remember, I come from school, my mother washed, I had to iron 32 blouses. That stuck in my brain, that 32. I never forgot it in 60 years.
Born in 1913, Anthony Richard Emanuele, in his high school days, was known as Tony King.
It ain't necessarily so. It ain't necessarily
He later teamed with Robert Bloch, famed author of Psycho, as the popular teenage comedians of that period. In his early adult years, he worked as manager of Gimbel's shoe repair department, and then went into business for himself. For the next 15 years, Tony held a custodial position with Milwaukee County, then retired in 1979. 7 years later, he suffered through a laryngectomy. His wife, Regina Jasinski, who he married in 1935, not only helped to create 13 children, but she also devoted much of her time in assisting Tony to adjust to his circumstances after his operation. In keeping with his natural sense of humor, he says that he can now at least communicate, but with a voice device that makes him sound like a space alien. Despite this setback, he continues to adjust courageously and live a comfortable life.
Oh, Jonah, he lived in the well. Oh, Jonah, he lived in the well. His home in that fish's abdomen, old Jonah, he lived in the well.
Being the oldest son of the family out of 12 kids, what was it like? Did they look up to you as the big brother?
No, they didn't look up to me like an asshole.
What are some of the most memorable experiences in your life?
I used to want to get this. When I was about 13 years old, I'd get that guy out of here. When I was 13 years old, I moved abroad about 25 in Cleveland, Ohio. But I'll never forget what happened. I never did such a thing in my life, and I'm telling you, I just couldn't get over it how it felt. And then when she said to me, "What's that stuff?" I said, "What stuff? What did some come out?" I said, "I don't know." That was one I'll never forget. And then what happened? I ran into the woods because I lived in a suburb from Cleveland, and I wound up with pneumonia. When I was 19 years old, I came home one day at 4 o'clock in the morning and my father punched me 3 times, 19 years old. And I looked and there was my sister, my brother-in-law, my mother, they were all laughing. And he cracked the goddamn door and my poor father was crying. He didn't want to get me divorced him.
What matters to you most right now?
Getting laid every day, 4 times.
Do you believe in God?
Yeah, I think that God knows that day. The only thing that bothers me, given you shall receive, I haven't received yet. I used to be Santa Claus at my brother Joe. He used to say, "Come on, Tony, when you coming out with my brother and get me out?" Every year I got, I gotta tell you what happened one Christmas day. I was supposed to be at my mother's house at a certain time. And as I was walking up Pine Street, I slipped on the ice and I fell. And the guy said, "Look at that drunken Santa Claus." I said, "Shut up, you son of a bitch." Your father, Chich, he was a comedian. If you want me, I can tell you a story what happened. When my father ate, everybody had his pieces at the table. And if one guy was missing or somebody would not eat, So one day your father came in, and to be honest, Bruce, he came in smoking a cigarette, and my father was ready to take the blade and throw it at him, and they stopped him, and he said, "Survivor, get you smoking another cigarette. You'll never walk in this, you're gonna get a beat, you'll never forget." So what did he do? He walked out and came home with a 9-inch cigar, the biggest one there was on my father's ass, and your father's been smoking cigars ever since. And I think another crazy brother of mine is my brother Gaz. Boy, if you ever go to Santa Fe, you'll have the time of your life. He's a nut compared to me. He made me feel like a peanut. Joe's all right. But I'll tell you one thing about my brother Joe, I'll never forget it. I was in Banja, like, I think it was Banja, like, yeah. And Joe was about 50 feet away from a woman. And she was talking. I couldn't hear the woman at all. Nobody. But my brother Joe fired her because he could read her lips. He's a crazy guy. And Joe's armless.
Born in Cleveland, Ohio, January 20th, 1916, Cost is variously known as Gust, Gustantini, and publicly called Charlie. During World War II, he served as a medic in New Guinea and Australia. In 1944 in Australia, he met and married Catherine Forrest. Then they moved back to the States. While they raised four children, Charlie maintained a successful Charlie's shoe repair shop in West Dallas for 25 years. Notorious during this time for his relentless, though good-humored, abuse of his customers, he was tagged as the Don Rickles of Greenfield Avenue. After retiring in 1984, Charlie and Kitty sold their shoe repair business in their home in New Berlin, Wisconsin, to settle amid 40 acres of scenic land in Santa Fe, New Mexico.
Kids.
What?
It's
he just wants
it's
a table.
Rolling now.
What do you want to do? Hurry up, for Christ's sake, the timer's over. It's 9 o'clock, I gotta go to
it's
bed.
It's a screen test, yeah.
I gotta go back home tomorrow.
Okay.
Compare the kids from when you were a kid to the kids from the 90s, these kids from today.
That's a good shot, because in my days, Dave, I was, before I went, when I was, say, 15, I had to quit school at 10th grade because we had no depression days. We had no dough. I used to sell two papers and make a penny. Then I quit that. I used to carry things. I used to have a 12 block area on the east side that I used to deliver papers. Cold, rain, or shine. And sometime I meet some wonderful customers. We used to eat in their houses. And my brother Vincent vouched for that. But we got along good. Then I quit that and I went into selling papers on the corners, yelling, selling two papers to make a penny. Then I got into, my mom said, "Why don't you go into shoe repair? You guys got a buck." So I got into the shoe repair, that's how I got, and then I was making only $3 a week. I was working for a Jewish fellow, he was good, but the guy didn't want to pay much. So I quit, I go back. My mom said, "Gee, what do you want to quit for?" I said, "Mom, the guy's only giving me $3 a week." So he comes out, this is no lie. I'm back to the house, look me over. I go back, he give me $5. I end up getting $8 a week after 5 years. By that time I was 24 years old. That's when I joined the 32nd Division National Guard. And a month after I joined, they shipped us out. I went for spring training at the down Louisiana for a year's training. We went in October. We're supposed to come back October of 1941. They knew the war was going to start anyway. So they put 6 months more on us. They gave us 18 months. 6 more months, they gave us 18 months. And everybody was saying, everybody over the hill in October, because that's when we were supposed to get out. By that time, the Japs came in. And that's how the economy started to build up. And that's why all the work is going today. And without that, now the Cold War is over. There's no work because there's no machinery, no tanks, no planes, no guns, no nothing. And it takes manpower and it takes human life sacrifice to keep the economy going. That's why, oh geez, that's why there's nothing going on today, because it's tough. But today, you know, you tell these young kids that, it's a killer. You tell them to do something, they get out of bed, they sleep all night, and they're tired. The first thing they do is want a soda. Well, the older generation, and a beer. You know, it depends. Sometimes they go out and have a good time, they come home 2 in the morning. How in the hell are you going to get up and go to school when you come home 2 in the morning and go to school, say 8 o'clock or 7:30? It's impossible. And then when they do get a job, first thing they want is a car. They got to have a car, otherwise it's no good. That's the difference in generations. I had a car. I bought it for 140 some bucks. When I went into service in 1940 on the call up, I sold it back to the guy that sold it to me for 140. When I got out, you couldn't touch a car because things were booming. Everybody was making big bucks. That's it. Thank you.
Okay, how would you like to be remembered?
Alive. I don't know what the hell they all they are.
But didn't you ever spend any time with them?
I can't remember my age without worrying about their... What?
Did you ever take them like to a park or on a picnic?
Park? Hell no, we had nothing to eat. How could you go picking them during the Depression? We used to get our food from the Con Relief. We had 6 bags of... We used to go to Con Relief. We used to put... One brother go here, potatoes. The other brother go there at the camps. And the other brother this. The other brother that. We used to give a guy a quarter to take it home. We had so much grocery. We'd eat good for a week, and after that we didn't eat nothing. Because we ate fast. We used to have our home on Jackson Street. We used to have in the basement, we had a kitchen. All the Italians got kitchens and basements. We used to go there. We used to cook fried potatoes till 4 in the morning. My brother Vince, he'd be studying. The rats would come out while we studied. We'd have fried potatoes, and that was it. But still, again, it's good remembrance. There was no hate. I'm sure there's no hate today, because we all got to make a buck. Help again, help each other. If you can't do it. I knew my brother Vince, he bought a home here where he's living now. When he first bought it, I used to go there and help him like hell, because the guy don't even know what a hammer was. He didn't even know what a shovel was. Today he's got a bad back. Because it was hard work for him. That guy was an educated brother, God bless him. Did a good living out of it, but still, he wanted help. I went there. I didn't want no credit. I did it because he needed help, because he didn't know what the hell to do. And that's it. Brother Joe, well, he's all right. We all got faults. Hey, we've been brothers for years. He can't hear, but he's still good. If he wants to help you, he'll do it.
What?
He's good. But we all got our troubles. Show me a family that doesn't give you an argument between brothers. But when we want to help each other, we be there together and help each other, try to help and do the things right, this one or that one. Sure we argued plenty. Oh, Christ, we used to fight like mad. Christ, we used, me and Sal, God bless this kid, him and I used to work at home. We used to help clean the house. Him and I used to do the painting. I would keep the furnace going during the cold winter months with the coal, bank it. My dad said, hey, go down there, fix up the stove. I'd go down there, bank it, get up at 4 in the morning, keep it going, throw out the ashes out the window. And Carl, they were tired. They work hard because they got responsibility. But that's the good part of the family. But we still got along great because they were good. I used to poke my brother Chich, by the way. I remember one time we had a fight in the basement, upstairs in our bedroom, up on Jackson Street. He got me so goddamn mad, I threw a bedpan at him, I cracked his teeth. Yeah, but still we get along great today. This is 50 years later, we're still getting along great. And that's what the family is again, together. You get some families here, they can argue, they'll shoot you tomorrow. It's no good.
When Veach was about 7 years old in Cleveland, Ohio, his brother Tony used him on street corners as a paperweight to keep his newspapers, the Cleveland Plain Dealer, from blowing away. Born March 28, 1918, Veach attended Marquette University, earning a liberal arts degree in 1941. 1 year later, he married Rose Manera, and in time produced a family of six. After World War II, he returned home from Saipan and Guam as a first lieutenant. He worked as a general traffic manager at Albert Trossel & Sons for 22 years and as a distribution manager at Finley Adhesives for 15 years. Now, he and Rose spend their retirement close to home, volunteering at Frodit Lutheran Hospital and serving on various committees for the Italian Community Center and Festa Italiana. Presently, he has been active with the Knights of Columbus, where he attained his fourth degree in 1988.
Okay, if you could speak directly to future generations, what would you tell them?
Well, I don't think we have enough time in a lifetime for me to point out the goals and aims of the future generations, but perhaps I can explain that better by telling you how I try to instill in my own family, my daughters and my sons, to be honest with themselves, to care for other people, to sympathize, to try to forgive and forget if things do go wrong, and persist in making sure that they lead lives that are exemplary. Maybe not the most famous, but at least model themselves so that they are honest, law-abiding Christians. I remember as a kid, my mother was called in the neighborhood Dona Maria. It's like Lady Maria. The fact that she was very energetic, extremely intelligent, although no formal education at all, whenever people were in perhaps physical trouble or some worrying about something, they would go to Dona Maria. She was like the wise owl, the sage of the neighborhood. When people were hurt, they would go to my mother because she had the stamina and the capability of handling bloodshed, broken bones, and she was very fearless and very very helpful. And that's inspiring. People would come to see her, even if I may recount something which in my mind is purely superstitious, but here's an example. My mother would be approached by people who wanted her to drive away a curse. In the Sicilians call it the malocchio, the evil eye, or a lucchiatura. So my mother was one of the few in the neighborhood as a matter of fact, it's the only one I knew in the neighborhood that was called upon at times. People would come to her with worries and anxieties, and her method of driving anything that might have been obsessed by the individual, if they had a headache or if they were worried, some bad luck or something impending, she would take a saucer, put water in it, and then drip into the saucer oil. And then in her some esoteric secret language, I call it gibberish, but she would say prayers, but when the oil was dropped onto the water, it would cause, water and oil don't mix, but it would show, the globules would show certain shapes she would interpret, and by doing that, somehow this would drive away whatever, if a person had a headache or was worried about something, she thought, and these people thought, well, she had the power and the spirit of driving away this particular system that my mother learned, incidentally, as a child. Years later, I asked my mother how she got this talent. She says, well, in my little town in Sant'Agata di Militello in Sicily, you had to go to church on a Christmas Eve. You had to learn a certain ritual, a certain language, and that's how you got this power. Of course, in my interpretation nowadays, to me it was purely psychosomatic. You know, I think you can talk a person out of a headache at times, or if you're in that mood, by association, clear away any of the anxieties. So there's the model that I and my sisters and my brothers, that you could see in all of them, that have this spirit of looking at and looking out for other people. Learned by Atsamariyutsa, my mother. As far as my talent, you might say, towards the music, I can't answer. All I know is when I was 4 years old, I was sleeping and I was wakened by a piano that my parents had purchased in Cleveland, Ohio. And it was a piano with rollers on. The music was amazing. And it just, I thought I was in a dream, and I woke up and there was this piano, and they bought it, really, for my sister Rose to take piano lessons. And somehow I just walked into this instrument that was in the house and just played around with it and listened. My father liked music. My mother liked music. They were not educated musically, but they had a love for nice, fine sounds, and maybe I had it, and somehow I just... My brothers perhaps concentrated more playing and enjoying themselves outside. As I say, as a youngster, maybe I was a kind of a bookwormish guy, stayed in the household out and just strummed around, and that's how the piano thing played. And I talked about my sister Rose being certainly the great mainstay in the Calarco tribe and family because of her talent, her love and respect for them and caring for them. Our brother Tony, in his high school days, was a natural comic. If he was in the right, many of us said those days, if my brother Tony had the right press agent, he'd probably have been one of the types of people, a stand-up comedian in the standard of Bob Hope or one of the other funniest guys. He was naturally tan. He's the one that produced the Abba Dabba Minstrels, which was a minstrel show sponsored by St. Rita's Church in 1940. Very talented and very caring guy. My sister Vivian, the youngest, the only great thing I ever did for that kid was, and that was by accident, she had peritonitis and was dying, and my blood matches hers, and I remember giving her blood transfusions. But you see, much of the activities and the environment there. I was departed because I was not at home very much.
Carlo?
Carlo, not much. Carlo, not much. Again, he was a little guy around. He was, he and Chichi, they had their social clubs and their social activities were not very much like mine because they had tended to gamble more in their lives and have that kind of a free spirit that I was never able to have, and I envy them for that.
Born May 1st, 1919, Joe is now the only left-handed Emanuele over 55. He is also the only athletic manager in Lincoln High School's recorded history who graduated in 4 years, but spent 6 years in the athletic locker rooms. Apprenticed as a butcher under Joe Zappaterreno and Tony Sedita, he learned his trade well and became a manager for Cramble Meat Departments in stores in Milwaukee and Fondulac, Wisconsin. Then with his wife, Geraldine Baston, who he married in 1944, and together raised 4 children, he finally ventured into his own business, the Emanuele Corner Store on 11th and Arthur. They also, on occasion, managed an outstanding catering service. After his wife, Jerry, passed away in May 1984, Joe decided to discontinue his supermarket and catering service. In 1978, he passed the state and national realtors examination. Now he continues to be active in real estate activities and is part-time butcher at a Southside store and restaurant.
I was assistant to the football coach, and he was offered a job to go to University of West Virginia, and he was going to take me, naturally, and a young man named Merton Copeland and a young woman named Gwen Hathaway. And it just so happened that before anything was done, he got sick. He had to go to the hospital, and he got tuberculosis and that. But the part that came to me was we had to play against Washington High School, and I was against Pat Harder and Al Scatt, some of the big pros that went on. They went on to being pros. But being a high school man, we had 3 assistant coaches. But they were good guys, they were wonderful men, but on the playing field they were little chickens. And I had the honor to run that team. We beat Washington 7-0, and I played a Newt Rockne style. I used to take 2-3 men out at a time, and it made me feel good. And we beat them, and that's what. The second memorial one I had is when I met my wife. I had a nice wife. She worked for me, but I never paid attention to her. I was strict with her. She'd come to work chewing gum and that. I made her spit it out. But the day I quit work, I asked her if she'd go out with me, and she was kind of surprised. But from then on, we hit it good, and I finally wound up marrying my wife, Geraldine. And that was my best experience. Well, I remember I took my mother to a picnic once, and I bought a 29 automobile, took her out a picnic, and it started to rain, and I put my parents in the car, and they really drowned to death because the car leaked. And my dad was going, "What'd you do?"
What do you think future generations will be like?
Ooh, that's a good one. I'm glad I'm not going to be around. Because from what I see today, it's going to be a catastrophe. I can't foretell, but from what I see today,
if Jesus doesn't come back pretty soon, we're going to have a real, real big mess. Went to school. We were on relief in those days. My father had it tough. The poor guy tried to make a go of us. And they used to give us shoes, which had rubber soles on them. And every time they got wet, your soles would be white. And I was ashamed to go to school. So my feet were bigger then and bigger now, but I used to force my brother's size 6 shoe and my 7 foot. And I used to come home hardly be able to walk, but I used to wear Charlie's shoes.
Did you ever borrow Uncle Cost's car?
Oh, I don't say I borrowed it. I used to take it. I used to drive his car around like mad. In fact, Ma used to call me, and even Johnny had a car. I think Johnny had a DeSoto. But I was a taxi driver at that time. I was always taking my mother around. The only part she didn't like is she always had to give me gas money. But I drove them cars all the time. And I was pretty nice about it. I always left them dry, no gas.
My brother Joe, he took my car. He's going down Wells Street. I said, bring it back. He brought it back. He ran into a streetcar by the city hall. And I never got a dime. Still owes me. And when once in a while, I used to give my, I'm this in Orlando. I give my car once in a while. Grandpa, my dad, take me here. We go in the car, wouldn't start. My dad would push me down the hill, down Lyon Street to get it started and go by the gas pump down on Lyon Street, fill up the tank. Then my father used to give me a couple bucks. At that time was, what, 25 cents a gallon. That's only time. But Joey never bought the car back to where I left it. It was always dry.
Aunt Rosie,
Uncle Tony,
when she was younger, she married young. She was a quiet woman. And didn't have too much to do with Rosie because she married so young. She had a husband, so. But I remember her husband. And he was very good to me. I recall when we lived in the Third Ward, he asked me one day if I'd take a walk with him to Wisconsin Avenue. So I said, sure. So I took a walk with him to Wisconsin Avenue. And then when we came back home, he slapped the hell out of me. And he asked me why I didn't wash my face when we went away.
The habit of stealing the show at weddings with his flamboyant dancing style. Born December 30th, 1922, John fought the Battle of World War II in Greenland. Then he apprenticed for 4 tough years in Cleveland, Ohio as a plasterer. Shortly after, following 2 previous marriages, he married Dolores Verheim in 1955 and together raised 4 children. Later, he became an integral part of Grandpa Joe Emanuele's East Side Plastering Company. After this business was liquidated, John was associated with Gateway Transportation Company Terminal in Milwaukee for 14 years. Then Gateway changed terminal operations and laid off most of its personnel. Since then, John has been engaged in his own construction business. In 1967, glaucoma was the cause of John losing his right eye. Still, he continues to adjust to his sight impairment by reading, driving, and successfully supervising his construction business. With only one eye now, John good-naturedly says he no longer has to worry about seeing both sides of any question. On April 22nd, 1991, following years of health ailments, John's wife, Dolores, passed away. 2 years later, John married Eleanor Gratz in May of 1993.
I was always a sucker in the family. was always being taken, always given something. Well, I remember one time I bought a bicycle. Well, anytime I wanted something, my mom gave it to me. I wanted a car, my mom bought it for me. Because I always gave my mother money. You know, and remember I had a two-wheel bike. Bought the first balloon tire bike, and Salto was playing with it. And he did something and it fell, and I got mad at him, and my brother Vincent G, but he almost cut his hand. And I said, I don't care. I said, he wrecked my bike. You know? Because whatever I had, I tried to earn. I earned it. I didn't get nothing for nothing. I always earned for what I got, and I still earning what I want. Seems like I'm still fighting for what I want.
What'd you do for fun?
The what?
What did you do for fun when you were a kid?
Played Cowboys and Indians and I worked at the Zingale's grocery store. I was a dump bastard in school, so I ended up going 5 miles every day to school in the morning, come home, put 60 quarts of milk in a cooler, come in the house. Maybe that summer, Ma would have some watermelon, which she bought five for a dollar. You had some watermelon, ran back to school, then come home at night and went back to work. That was my life. I worked all my life. And I'm wondering, when the fuck is it going to stop? Maybe that's why all my life I was a scavenger. I was always scavenging something, you know, picking stuff up. I was always trying to make a nickel or a dime. I always tried that. My mom used to get a kick out of that because I was always trying to find a way to make a dollar. Especially when I was scavenging them houses next door from her. Robbed them houses blind, huh? One time, house next door from my mother's house, I saw an electric circuit box and I wanted it. So I went in there and I didn't know that the electricity was coming from underneath the street. And when I did something wrong, I cut, and I saw a big flash. As long as I didn't get burned, I didn't care, you know. So my son John, Johnny had to be maybe 7 or 8 years old. And he said, Pa, are you stealing? And I said, hell no, I ain't stealing. He said, the guy told me I could have this stuff. Then my mom would come out, and she'd look in the basement, and she'd say, John, you better get out there. The policemen are coming to get you. And I said, ah, Ma, come on. So anyway, I got all through with this stuff. I went by next door. And Jesus says to me, Johnny, the lights don't work in our house. I said, so? She said, but half the lights don't work. I said, so? What do I got to do with it? Well, she says, funny, they don't work, you know. I said, I don't know. I didn't know. So on the way going home, in front of John Ernst, and here's the electric company. The guy's down in the middle of the street, you know, to open the manhole. Down in there, Johnny says, Pa, maybe something did go wrong. He said, there's a guy's working on an electric company. Well, I found out I cut half the block off the power. I short the whole goddamn, I closed John Ernst out.
Do you believe in God? No?
I'm having trouble.
Why?
I don't know. I was told by Eleanor, my wife of course, I said something one day, she said, well, John, she said, you think you don't believe him, but you talk about him, so she said that's a good sign. Now that we're married, when we were up at our hometown, we went to talk to the priest up there, and I asked him, she was married before in a church. She got married in a Catholic church. And I want the marriage blessed. I think a lot of it got to do with not hearing. I used to go to church, and you sit in the church, and you don't hear nothing. It's like TV. There's certain people I understand, some people I don't understand. So when I go to church, it's very boring for me. I fall asleep. Fell asleep for my wife's funeral. Fell asleep from my brother Frankie's funeral. I fell asleep from my grandson Michael's funeral. It's not that I wasn't interested, I couldn't hear nothing. And then sometimes I keep saying, is there a God, really? Is there one? You know, and it's hard for me to believe there is one. Even though I try to listen to stuff, I look at this world and I wonder, is there one? You see all the shit that's going on, you know? It's hard for me to believe it. I hope I change. I hate to think of myself as an atheist. I don't tell everybody don't believe in them, because that's your own prerogative. I'm one of them guys, if you want to get an abortion, it's your business, not mine. Well, that's the way I feel about church. Theresa was another one I got along with pretty good. Sister Theresa, or Vivian too. After I got divorced from Mabel, I was living in the house and I'd have to make my lunch. Big deal, you know. He gave it something for it. Made him work for it. Even to make my lunch, it was work for it, but they did something for it. And that's what I did. My brother Carlo's a very hard worker. And I wish he'd slow down. Because someday at work he's gonna get his ass. But Carlo's a hardworking kid, a hardworking man. And everything he's got, he earned it. Nobody gave it to him, he earned it. So I ain't got nothing to say about Carlo. Even when he was young, he was a hard worker. We worked together at plastering. He was always a hard-working bastard. At first, he was pretty stupid with his money, as far as gambling is concerned. But after that, I think he caught on. I think one day he says to me, that goddamn Mary's been doing a novena. He said, lately I don't want to gamble. He said, I think she's putting a curse on me. And he'll always make up a story. Bill Johnson's favorite words were, Carlo, if you told the truth, you'd choke to death. And that's Carlo. It was his favorite words.
Born in Cleveland, Ohio, March 27, 1925, little Mariusz's constant humming used to fascinate her sister Rosa's husband, Frank. Her childhood humming, we understand, turned to a robust yelling, which she aimed at her 8 children. Besides being a productive mother, Mary was the attractive cashier of the village cobbler, which her husband, Vince Longo, who she married in 1947, managed in downtown Fond du Lac, Wisconsin. Mary and her husband retired in early 1987, and now Vince enjoys himself as an official gopher for a carpet and tile concern in Fond du Lac. Both Mary and Vince continue to be deeply involved in their St. Patrick's Church activities.
Short and fast.
If you could speak to future generations, what would you tell them?
What would I tell them? I can't think of what I'd tell them. Just lead a good moral life. And don't worry always about money. Worry about your health and your family, if you have a family. My most recent dream is I dreamt of my son Jude, and I dreamt he was going to Notre Dame, and I went to see him, and he come down there, and he looked just like when he was a teenager, and he said, Mom, I need a quarter for something, and I got a quarter for him, and then he says, don't worry about me, he says, I'm doing just fine, and that was one of the recent dreams that I had. What matters most to me is that my children have health and that they have their children, they have good families, and that my husband and I stay healthy. That's what matters to me the most.
Is it true your family used to refer to you as Marilyn Maxwell?
Oh yeah, that's just a
tell us
fooling
about
around. No, that's it. I don't know why. There is no resemblance, and I think
who
it's
is she?
An actress. It's just a big joke.
I never looked like her.
What year?
Oh, that's when I was single. Well, you know, when I was much younger, when I was in my 18, 20s, in the 20s. That was when they used to, they still kid me about it, but I can't see it.
Do you have any hobbies?
Hobbies?
Yeah.
Yeah, I walk. I work crossword puzzles, and I love to read.
What was your last book?
Oh, God, I can't remember the title. I like all these romantic novels that come out with perfect endings and no hogwash. Life is too hard to begin with, so I get lost in my books.
When you got married, how was it moving away from the family? Did you feel isolated from the family? And how did Grandma react to you moving so far from home?
Well, my mother never said much, but it was hard on me because I was used to a big family and my husband is an only child. And it took me quite a while, and we never could get back and forth that much, even though it wasn't that far because we didn't have a car. And I missed the family very much. I missed them very much, and my parents, my mother and my dad especially.
What did Grandma say when you left?
Oh no, she felt, Grandma couldn't feel anyway because Grandma left her parents when she married my dad, and that was across the ocean. So she really didn't make a big fuss about it at all. The one I got along with most is Johnny, because we were about 2 years apart and we were very close. And he was real good to me, and not that the other boys weren't good to me. You know, not that the other kids weren't good to me. They were all, my brothers were all nice to me. I mean, how could they help it? I'm so nice.
Anything you'd like to say to maybe people that are watching this 50, 60 years from now?
Well, I would say, I don't know what to say. I said, keep your morals well. And I always felt that if you had a little religion in you and believed in God, that will help you through a lot of hard times. Prayer. That's how I feel. And I think it would help if people were like that.
How would you like to be remembered?
How would I like to be remembered? Well, I'd like to be remembered as Mary, the good old gal. That's...
Born June 14, 1927, Sal was the last of the Emanueles born in Cleveland, Ohio. When Sal arrived in Milwaukee at 15 months of age, he swapped diapers with his newly born nephew, yours truly, Alex Calarco, who also migrated to Milwaukee. Sal's talented mechanical ability helped him to become an expert carpet lane journeyman. During World War II, he served his country in France. Married in 1952, he and his now former wife, Barbara Tantoni, raised six children. His claim to fame as a youngster was his role in the Thanksgiving Day play at Cass Street School. His sole recitation was, "Tea is for turkey, Sam wants a sandwich." Presently, Sal and his wife Shirley Wagner, who he married in 1985, make their home in Phoenix, Arizona.
What matters to me most is I'm hoping that someday we can actually get things, situations would work out where we can take a good long trip back home without the dog.
I do remember the convalescent home. That was, I was a kid, and I had an operation in it, and I was in a convalescent home out what they call today New Berlin. And when my mother and dad came, they would bring some of the kids, like Chich. And I found out from my nurses that these guys, Chich and some of the other ones going out there, were always out by the farmer's land causing trouble. So Ma had to quit bringing them out. That's one of the things I remember. And I was about, oh, maybe 11 years old for my operation on my ribs from a boil.
Describe a typical day for you.
Well, the good day, like down here now, is going to Kmart and welcome all good and bad that come into the store of welcome to Kmart. And I think it's just great to be out in the field, and I've learned many, many things compared to what I used to do and know with people. Well, I think years back at my time, I think there was a lot more respect for your elders than there is today. And I also think that I stand to be corrected, that a lot of people today, young people, is gimme, 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 and they'll take it. And as a rule, don't give that much back. They're always out to grab. Bros. Well, I remember one time I was a young fella, and I got in trouble with a next door neighbor involved. I don't know how, but I was involved, and I got a little sassy with a neighbor, and their name were Mr. and Mrs. Jittle, that lived across what they called John Ernest's lot. And these people ended up talking to Brother Veach, and of course he, Brother Veach, approached me with a talk that, which I always thought was fantastic. He always was and still is, and had me going back to these elderly people and giving an apology, which I will never forget, and I never regretted it. Grandma not only put me to work around odd jobs, she drove me to insanity. Because one of my children, I believe, have a picture that when I look at it, in one hand, I have a hammer, the other one I got a saw. And I went, is this the way I was born in? Because I was forever working. I never left the house. You'd think I was in Sing Sing on Jackson Street.
I remember one day I just got out of the service, and they had a 5220 club, which you got unemployment checks for 52 weeks, $20 a week. One Saturday morning, I got about 8 checks. That was about $160. My buddy Joe called me up. We started a crab game at 10 o'clock in the morning. We didn't finish until 6 o'clock at night, and I came out the winner. I think I won about $3,500. I had money all over my pockets and the thing. I came home, and I ran upstairs to the bedroom, and I Oh, my dad was at the, yeah, he was at the porch, right, and he saw me, and right away, I ran upstairs. He says, what are you doing? I said, nothing. I went upstairs in the bedroom, and I took all this money out, and the money was like this. I said, he came in, I said, where'd you get all this money from? I said, Pa, don't worry about it. I didn't steal it. I gave him a handful of money. I said, I'll be right down. So that was it. Gamble. The best thing in my life was gambling and smoking good Cuban cigars and being dressed up.
Nicknamed Chichi or Chich, Frank was the first Emanuele, born in Milwaukee on January 19, 1929. When only a youngster, Chichi played the role as Alfalfa in Brother Tony's Abba Dabba Minstrels of 1940. Chichi's favorite cigar was the stubby Italian Pirati, which was so strong that if you couldn't see him, you would smell him. In World War II, he served in the Army, the Air Force, the Marines, even the Coast Guard. In 1954, he married Concetta Pappalardo and together produced four children. Although he was an expert in selling burial monuments, he was also associated with Interstate Freight Systems' Milwaukee Terminal. In February 1986, he created the Bonafide Heating and Air Conditioning Company, and along with his wife Connie and sons, helped to make the company very successful. In March of 1992, after repeated complications following heart surgery, Connie passed away. 5 months later, on August 23rd, 1992, still battling hard over the loss of his wife, Frank followed her by taking his own life.
Yeah, well, I got nicknamed Vale Jackson Street by Frankie Peachel because I was always dressed up. Always had a suit on and a tie and smoked them big cigars, so they used to call me the Mayor Jackson Street. That was about that. Where are you getting all this information from? I've always hung around with guys 10, 15 years older than I was. Always. And I think that was very, very educating because I got 15 years ahead of myself. That helped me out pretty good.
Where did you get your nickname from?
Chichi? My brother Tony. He named everybody. He named me Chichi. He named my brother Salter Shaves and Bongo. Polak. My brother Tony was good at that. He's the one that did all the nicknames. I think I got to be just like him at my older age. I always got along with Vince. But, you know, my brother Vince is an intellectual, and we worked with our hands. I worked more as an intellectual than I did with my hands. So I don't know. I got along with Vince good. I got along with all my brothers. There was never, I think, coming from a big family like I did, I think we got along real good. Terrific. I remember Carlo used to have a paper out, and I used to take his money to go gamble with it, and then pay him back about 2 weeks later. Yeah.
Why? Tell that story.
Well, she used to talk real funny. This was Mrs. Tarantino. She lived on Line Street, and she used to talk real funny with her nose like this. My father nicknamed her Boom. My father had a nick. I think that's how I got started. Everybody I see, I give him a name or who he looks like. My dad started that stuff. He had a name for everybody. I don't want to mention too many names here because maybe they'll see this. I'm just going to lay low on the names.
What about the lady with the vacuum cleaner?
Oh, Mrs. Casio. Oh, she was wonderful. I used to drive her nuts. They lived right next door. And if I used to go to her every day, and if I missed a day, she would say, Chichi, where is it? I had to go there. one day she gave me an old vacuum cleaner she wanted me to fix because it didn't work. And I fixed it. And then I went up to her and I showed her. She said, "I did so." In other words, she meant, "Did you fix it?" I said, "Yeah." And ever since then, I nicknamed her Ajizzo.
What about the lady next door that gave you wine? Or didn't it? Next door gave you wine all the time?
That was after Cascio. That was Mr. Filippo's wife. Scalici. Mrs. Scalici. Yeah. No, she didn't give me no wine. 10 cents a glass.
Female Emanuele, born in Milwaukee on Christmas Day 1931. Her dark complexion is the only one to match her brother John's. In 1953, Teresa married Peter Panzarella and together produced one son. In the following years, her quiet but tireless energy would be an asset as an assistant to Peter, who was regarded at the town club as one of the Milwaukee's finest chefs. Teresa and Pete lived with Ma many years on Jackson and watched over her even after Pa passed away in 1961. When the Jackson Street home was demolished in 1968 because of a proposed freeway, they shared their new home with her for an additional 15 years until the summer of 1983. Teresa, now retired, and Pete continued to visit family, enjoy their grandchildren, and visit their cottage in northern Wisconsin.
Baby, it's cold outside. The answer is no. Baby, it's cold outside.
The welcome is
how lucky that you dropped in. Look out the window.
Okay, describe an average day for you.
Let's see. I get up in the morning. I have a cup of coffee. Say goodbye to Pete when he goes to work. Grab a rag. And grab a... Windex and a can polish, and I start going through the whole house. And then about 11:30, I call up Rose, my sister Rosie, ask her how she's doing. And then at 12 o'clock, I watch my soap. And that's it. And that's, don't be a follower. Do whatever you like, but watch you, who you hang around with, what you do. In fact, my dad used to walk down Jackson Street and say I'm the proudest man. I could walk with my head up in the air because I have 8 boys and 4 daughters, and I never had a cop come to the door. If the future generation, including my grandchildren and my nieces and nephews, if they take after their 8 uncles and 4 aunts, they'll have it made. Well, when I was a kid, we didn't know anything, and we didn't know what dope was. We didn't know what sex was, because we were told to keep your skirts down. You know, you weren't allowed, or we used to go to the drugstore and have sodas, but you know, or go to the show. But now they can do anything they want. They smoke pot, they do this, and they do that. In our days, we never heard of that stuff.
Did you ever play a musical instrument?
Yeah. An electric toy organ was at Christmas time with my mother. And, let's see, yeah, she was playing a broom that looked like a guitar, and I was playing the organ, and we all sang Jingle Bells. That's the only time I played an instrument.
Who else was there?
Aunt Rose, Nance, Carol, and Vince was taking movie pictures. Well, I say, well, my mother, God bless her, when she would get in a turmoil, or she'd get mad at Grandpa, or she would, I don't know why you're making me say this, but she would lock herself in the bathroom, and she didn't get her way or did something. I don't know what it was. All I could remember was she'd go, "Give me the rat poison. I'm going to kill him myself. Give me the rat poison. I don't want to stay here." And my dad would say, "What are you so? Please come out, please." And then she'd open the door and we'd give her the smelling salt and she'd be over it.
Pete and Aunt Rosie was the older, she was older than you. Did she sometimes play a mother figure?
Oh yeah. Oh yeah, she was. In fact, I heard when I was little, she breastfed me and my grandma breastfed Joey. When we were, because we were six, Joey and I are 6 months apart, Joe Calarco and I are 6 months apart. And if her grandma would go somewhere, Aunt Rose would take care of me, I was told, and she breastfed me. And then if Aunt Rose went somewhere, that's the one I'm a nervous wreck. Well, we'll go with Tony. I remember when we used to go there after supper, we were allowed to go, and we'd go with Vivian and Sophie and Mary Rose. We'd have a ball just watching them. He'd make us laugh.
Oh, yeah.
And I remember my brother Vince, when my mother had to wake him up in the morning, he would never get up, so she had to take a wet towel and put it on his head. My brother Charlie used to knock on the kitchen table and then point to either one of us what he wanted. Let's see, Johnny used to give me 50 cents a week for making his lunch because he didn't like the way my dad made it. My brother Joe, it was one Christmas during the war, and my mother, grandma, didn't want to have a Christmas tree. So Joe felt sorry for us, so he went to the store and he went out, bought a Christmas tree, and bought all kinds of gifts. He brought it home, and Chich was there. So we had us go upstairs, and I wrapped Mary, and I wrapped whoever was home. And when it was my turn, they wrapped my gift, which was a mirror and a comb and a brush set. And then he sent Chich to the drugstore for 20 boxes of tinsel Chich bought. Chich stood about 2 feet away from the tree and threw all 20 boxes of tinsel that it looked, and at the end, the tree looked beautiful. And Mary, I used to sleep with her in that little room, and she used to read these books, and then at night, about a quarter to ten, I'd say, or 9 o'clock, I'd say, "Mary, would you like me to go to the store and get your book to the drugstore?" "No, no, I don't want any." 5 minutes to ten, I had to run to the drugstore with a dime and go buy her book at the time. And see, Sal, well, him and I used to argue a little, but we got along. In fact, he was my first charge. Sal opened it up for me, he co-signed, and I haven't been stopped charging ever since.
The shark, babe, has such teeth there, and it shows.
Also known as Carl, Carlo is the youngest of the eight Emanuele brothers, born March 30th, 1936. As a youngster, Carlo's wardrobe was probably the largest of Milwaukee due to the fact that he inherited the hand-me-downs from 7 brothers. In his early adult years, Carlo's quick wits frequently made him a winner in the art of playing games, those with 52 cards, that is. In time, his mechanical abilities won over and he took to learning plastering and carpet laying. In 1956, he married Mary Tamboli and together raised 6 children. After being employed by Tom Bolcow from 1972 to 1986, he became a partner in the Commercial Floor Covering Company Incorporated, which, with the assistance of his wife Mary, has become one of the more successful industrial floor covering companies in southeastern Wisconsin.
Down by the river, don't you know, where a cement bag just drooping on down. Oh, that cement is just, it's there for the weight.
Praise you.
Okay. Question number one.
Okay, if you could speak directly to future generations, what would you tell them?
Tell them all to go fuck themselves.
Why?
Because it's all screwed up, the whole system. They're all lazy, worthless bastards.
Okay, how are you doing?
How am I doing? I'm doing great.
I feel good and everything?
Oh, I feel great. I feel real good. Except for my toe, my back, my fucking knees, my arms, my fingers. I feel great.
Describe your most recent dream.
I won the lottery. And I woke up, there wasn't a fucking thing there. Bro.
What are some of your earliest memories?
My earliest? When I won $900 at the dog track.
Do you believe in God, and why?
Do I believe? Sure I believe in God. Why? Why? What the fuck do I know why? I believe in God. There is a God.
What do you think future generations will be like?
Bad. Nothing like my generation.
Why?
How's that?
Why? Because they're...
Times are tough. Real tough. It's not like it was when I was 18, 19 years old. Back then, you know, if you quit a job, you had a job the next day. Now, shit. Any job you get now, most of the times, $4 an hour, $5 an hour. Rents are so, you know, and everything is so high, everybody is just, they're not going anywhere. There's nothing out there right now, absolutely nothing. And all this college shit, they could stick up their ass. A lot of them should go to learn a trade. There's too many. Everybody's going to college. There's no more working people. Everybody wants to be a fucking white-collar man.
Describe an average day for you.
Tough. Average?
Yeah.
Well, I get up at 4:45, 5:30. Get up, take a shit. Put the coffee on, smoke 4 cigarettes, get in my truck, go down to the office, stay there for about an hour, then go out to the jobs, work a little bit, go check some of the jobs out, go back to the office, listen to all the bullshit down at the office, sit there till sometimes 5:30, get the work schedule all set up for the next day. Then after that, go to a tavern, have a few drinks, and come home. Our family was pretty at home when I was on Jackson Street. You know, Vivian and I are about were the last ones.
Right, right.
But the most of them were older. We were pretty, I would almost have to say, pretty tight, you know, pretty close family, everybody, you know. Anytime something happened or whatever, I was living home when I was young, everything used to come to 1426 North Jackson by Grandma. And Grandma was the, you know, the general of the family. Grandpa would sit there with his wine and, yeah, Mama, what he used to call him, Maria or whatever.
Mariusa.
Yeah, Mariusa. But Ma had the pair of balls in the house, Grandma. She was, you know, not that, that she was, you know, mean to my dad or anything, but Grandpa used to was kind of laid back. You know, things would bother him, but Grandma used to, you know, she used to rule. She was the boss. You have to go to Grandma. You sit there and try to bullshit her. Every Sunday when my brother-in-law Frank was living, every Sunday was for about, I would say almost, about 1 or 2 years, Mary? When I used to go by at my sister Rosie's house every Sunday morning we used to sit and drink a quart of booze.
me, Buckety, and my brother-in-law, Frey. And sometimes somebody else would join us, but it was every Sunday we'd go there and sit at the kitchen table, bullshit, smoke, and drink a whole bottle of booze, and brother-in-law Frank would buy it. Every Sunday. That went on for about 5 years. Every Sunday. Uncle Tony had a shoe shop, and I used to work for him at his shoe shop. He was never there. He was always loaded. Me and Spud. And Buck. Spud. Spudagino. Spursino. I used to hang around with him. He knew the family. He passed away a couple of years ago. But Tony used to leave, and Spud and I used to watch the gas station, the shoe shop for me, a shoe shop on Ogden Avenue. And every time you went down looking for something, you found an empty half pint laying somewhere underneath the cabinets. What about him? Do I know anything about him?
Yeah.
I could talk to you for 9 hours on Uncle Joe. Big pain in the ass, he always got shafted. He's had 9 businesses, and he says he never got a break.
You know, well, let's put it this way. Talk to your granddaughter. If you want to say anything to her when she's 25 or 30 years old, that you might not be around to say anything to, what would you say to her? Now.
I don't know, Joe. Like, I don't know. She's gonna know me. I know what I follow what you mean, but I don't have anything really to say to my future. Family, nieces, and all that.
Her daughter.
Her
grandchildren.
That she got a good grandpa. And grandma.
Tiny Viv is not only the smallest of the first generation of Emanueles in the United States, but also the youngest, born January 11, 1938. As an aunt, Vivian had the unique experience of having had her diapers changed by a nephew and a niece. In 1956, she married John Podlesnik and together raised a family of 6. Vivian's high mental aptitude and industry made her an asset in the accounting department at the Joseph Schlitz Brewing Company. Years later, when Schlitz closed its Milwaukee plant, she was hired by the Johnson Controls Company. In the summer of 1983, Vivian and John shared their home with Ma and personally sacrificed a great deal of their personal time in making life more tolerable and comfortable for her during her last years.
Grandma and Grandpa never pushed me to do anything, because in the Italian families, everything was for the boys. And the girls were, you're supposed to grow up, you're supposed to get married, you're supposed to have children, and if you marry an asshole, well, that's too bad, you just stick it out and go through it. No, but that's how we were brought up.
If you could speak directly to future generations, what would you tell them?
Just be careful what you do. And when you go to pick someone that you think you're going to spend the rest of your life with, make the right choice. Hope you make the right choice. And if you have a family, treat your children good, treat your husband good. Material things aren't everything, because as far as I'm concerned, I'd rather have the love of my kids and my husband than all new furniture, all knickknacks. Because material things
that's nothing. Because you can have all the money in the world, but if you have a family that doesn't treat you good, or if you're sick, what does it mean? So I think it's what people, how people treat you and what they think of you.
Sure.
I dreamt of my sister-in-law, Connie, and she was in a car. And I don't know what the heck she was doing in this car, but she was like cleaning the interior of the car, she was wiping off the windows, and she was laughing and laughing and laughing. Then all of a sudden I was in a room, and my sister-in-law Dolores was in the room. There was like a bunch of people around her, and she looked really nice, and she had red hair, short, fixed real nice, but she didn't say a word to me. That's the last dream I remember.
How would you like to be remembered? How would you
in
like
a good
to?
Way, and I is somebody who was nice, funny, compassionate. I think that's about it. Oh, nice looking.
Describe how your older brothers and sisters treated you.
Well, they treated me like I was the baby of the family, and in fact, I am 54 years old now, and they still treat me like the baby of the family. I remember my brother Chich, I was 15 years old, and I stood up for Aunt Teresa's wedding, and after that I started to wear lipstick. My mother and father never said a word. He bitched me out to no end because I was wearing lipstick. That's how they treated me. They still do that to me. They treat me good though, you know, but they still, I am considered the baby. Oh, when there was supper, well, first of all, I never ate what Grandma made because I was real fussy.
Uh-oh.
I wish I would have stayed that way. And one time she took me to the doctor. She told me this, the doctor said, leave her alone. She'll eat when she gets hungry. She said, I almost died. I never ate. And I used to wait for Grandpa. I used to sit out on the front stoop waiting for Grandpa to come home from work because he always brought me home a candy bar. And then I used to like to sit on his lap and touch his ears because he always had these real cold ears. And Grandpa hit me once. He didn't really hit me, he just picked me up by the thing and he threw me in a chair. Grandma, well, that's another story. She used to slap me and pinch me. And Aunt Mary, my sister Mary, used to beat the hell out of me. One time I was sitting on the basement steps and Grandma's washing clothes and I probably was just a little crybaby and I wanted something. And I must have been, you know how kids are when they keep nagging. Finally, Aunt Mary came up to me and she slapped me so hard across the face. I'll never forget that. Grandma didn't even do anything. She just let her hit me.
You don't know why?
Because I was being a pain in the ass, probably.
Uncle Veach?
I used to babysit for him once in a while. I used to take a... He used to live on 26th and Ruby, and I used to go there with a girlfriend of mine, and we'd babysit for about 8-9 hours, and then he'd give us $5, and then we took a cab home, and it cost us $4.50 to get home, so we split the... only once did that, otherwise we took the bus. I met your father by Uncle Tony's house. In fact, when your father met me, I had blonde hair. I had it peroxide, and I had it real short like this. Yeah, except the back was short. And for the longest time, he thought my name was Virginia. I don't know where the hell he got that from. But then one day, I guess he asked somebody, I don't know if it was Sophie or Dita, how come your Aunt Virginia's got blonde hair in the front and black hair in the back? Yeah, I was 16 years old when I met Dad.
Oh,
copia de simpatica stella, allora mio cuore si impiega da cuore. In cielo sta scritto, il nostro trino, ven un giorno noi sposeremo.